Hello, my name is Alyssa Junkins.
I'm Elizabeth Hale.
And I'm Teresa Tompkins.
And we are with Holy Cross College at Notre Dame, Indiana. Today, we will be discussing the details of depression and anxiety as seen in college students and how to recognize and mitigate the effects. Depression, affecting 32.8% of the United States population and 41.6% of the college-age population, it is the most common mental illness in the country. Out of all students currently attending a secondary school in America, 19% have been diagnosed with moderate depression and 22% have been diagnosed with severe depression. With the average depression rate in college students being 35.8% in 2013, there has been a 116% overall increase in just 8 years. According to the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, or DSM-5, depression is a common and serious mental illness that negatively affects how a person feels, thinks, and acts through a constant state of sadness and loss of passion. Some symptoms include fluctuating appetite, trouble sleeping or oversleeping, increased fatigue, slowed movements of speech, feeling worthlessness, difficulty concentrating, and thoughts of death and/or suicide. Depression can occur at any time of your lifetime. However, it first appears in the late teens to mid-20s of the average person. What is the difference between moderate and severe depression? Severe depression symptoms more commonly provide issues at a person's home and work and their social life. They form a barrier, creating difficulties when trying to perform everyday tasks. Along with the consistent feeling of worthlessness, those struggling with severe depression can also suffer from increased agitation. In moderate depression, the person will experience no more than 4 of the previously stated symptoms, and these symptoms typically do not last longer than 2 weeks at a time. Personal care may be neglected by those struggling with both moderate and severe depression, such as cleaning your living spaces, daily hygiene, and spiritual care. Many factors of college can contribute to the development of depression symptoms. Many students are dealing with the transition of living with their parents to living alone, on top of debt caused by student loans, academic stress, and concerns for their future career paths. During the 4 short years at college, a student is expected to juggle schoolwork, a source of income, social life, and deciding what they want to do for the rest of their lives. All of these stressors can tear down on a person's mental health, making it a lot easier for college students to develop depression or anxiety when compared to other age groups. Depressive substance abuse is also more common in college students. They are more likely to binge drink, smoke marijuana, take harder drugs, or participate in risky sexual behavior in order to distract themselves from their interior emotional pain. One common misconception made by society is that depression and grief are the same thing. Although they may share some similar features, such as extreme sadness, the grieving process comes in waves. Whereas in major depression, the symptoms last consistently for a minimum of 2 weeks. When grieving, a person's self-esteem often is maintained, contrary to depression, where it is common to experience self-loathing and worthlessness. The Perks of Being a Wallflower, a young adult book written by Stephen Chomsky, later turned into a movie in 2012, covers the trauma and stress that led to a high school boy falling into a depressive spiral. Going into his first year of high school, the main character, Charlie, is struggling with the mental pain of losing his best friend to suicide. His best friend was struggling with severe depression, but hid it from the public so well that no one could tell until he was no longer with them. With all of this emotional trauma placed on Charlie at such a young age, he was prone to blackouts, where upsetting memories were subconsciously blocked out of his mind. He was also prone to constant breakdowns, especially when he experienced flashback memories of the trauma that developed into his depression. Charlie learned throughout the movie to surround himself with the friends in his life that truly cared for him. For young adults and teenagers struggling with severe depression, friends and family act as a life vest, keeping them afloat when their emotions become too much to handle. Towards the end of the movie, Charlie does contemplate suicide. However, it is the love shown from his friends, sister, and parents that gave him the strength to keep battling. The Perks of Being a Wallflower shows viewers about trauma and depression and how to survive it. As college students, we experience stressors in our daily lives that can spiral into depression, just as they did for Charlie. Just because a student did not demonstrate symptoms of depression before attending university does not mean they will not appear during these 4 years. By educating ourselves on what depression and anxiety is and what symptoms it can cause, we can be conscious of its development and seek help before it becomes severe. So, much like depression, anxiety disorders are among some of the most prevalent disorders today, especially among college students and other young adults. A study done by Penn State University found that over 60% of college students struggle with some sort of anxiety, to the point where they report it as one of their major health concerns. That same study also found that the reported anxiety among college students doubled from 2008 to 2016. But what exactly is anxiety? Generalized anxiety disorder is difficult to diagnose because of common misconceptions about the disorder and confusion with regular, every day-to-day stress. So for instance, many people associate panic attacks with anxiety, but the DSM-5 says that generalized anxiety disorder is often not even associated with panic attacks of any kind, but rather is characterized by the presence of excessive worry that is difficult to control for at least 6 months and is accompanied by at least 3 of these physical symptoms: restlessness, fatigue, impaired concentration, irritability, increased muscle aches, or difficulty sleeping. Anxiety can very often be confused with regular stress or worry, but one way to distinguish between the two is that anxiety often comes with a sense of impending doom, and you will be stressed even when there is no specific risk involved. Unfortunately, freshman and first-year college students are particularly at risk for anxiety. Our vulnerability to anxiety is due to the fact that the support system that we have built up over the course of our life is suddenly mostly unavailable to us. There are constant risks everywhere. In addition to changes in eating and sleeping habits, we have to make new friends and get used to a new environment without anyone there who can reinforce the identity that we built up in middle and high school. All of this is compounded by the stress of taking college classes, the pressure to do well for fear of failure, losing scholarships, disappointing people, etc. Your first year away from home is really the time when issues with how you were raised can come to the surface. A study done on parent-child attachment and anxiety showed that your connection to your parents when you were little plays a huge role in how psychologically resilient you are. This study found that students who had poor parent-child attachment growing up are less psychologically resilient and therefore more likely to develop anxiety, and moving away from home can sometimes be the test of this parent-child attachment and therefore psychological resilience. So how does psychological resilience and parent-child attachment play a role in anxiety specifically? So as we established, it's no secret that moving away from home is a stressful experience, as is trying to do well in school while also balancing a social life. When anyone experiences these for the first time, their natural anxiety levels increase or go up. However, in a person with lower psychological resilience, a stressor such as moving away to college can be devastating for their mental health. As anxiety levels go up, sleep deprivation increases, which inhibits academic performance, another cause for anxiety, and so the cycle continues. It turns into a positive feedback loop. And this is part of the problem with anxiety, is that the symptoms are really part of the issue. But what does this mean for you as college students and for us? So first, it is important to be able to recognize in yourself if you are starting to develop generalized anxiety disorder. So often, besides the normal nervousness, elevated heart rate, constant need to go to the bathroom, stuff that's normally associated with anxiety, this disorder is also accompanied by increased irritability and emotional outbursts. Even if you didn't struggle with mental health before college, I think that it would be well worth your while to periodically do a sort of mental health check and make sure that you are taking care of yourself mentally, physically, emotionally. Check for symptoms of depression and anxiety, and don't be alarmed if you notice a change in mental health. So all of this was kind of a bit of a downer, but don't worry, there are ways to combat this. Teresa has some really awesome tips for us.
So as my colleagues discussed earlier, we as college students often struggle with depression and anxiety because of the various challenges and changes that we are faced with. It is important, it is vital, that we especially as college students find healthy and practical strategies to balance our mental health with that of the many demands and pressures we undergo. Before I begin giving examples of natural remedies and ways to treat depression and anxiety, I must first address that while these tips are means to benefiting mental health, they are not the only solution. In fact, these remedies will not be the solution if you are experiencing a consistent wave of depression and anxiety that is hindering your ability to function in daily life. Counseling and medication should be sought out and are highly encouraged. Nonetheless, these daily living tips will prove to be beneficial long-term for your overall health and well-being. They are especially helpful for when we are experiencing a sense of homesickness, sadness, and stress during our college years. With this in mind, I'd like to begin on the remedies for depression. So a healthy and well-balanced diet is an underestimated way to reduce depression. What you choose to eat daily will have an impact on not only how your body functions, but also with your mood. It's important that we keep our guts clean as well as the good bacteria working. Eating carbs with high glycemic content feeds bad bacteria, which will eventually affect digestion and our mood, since such sugars will cause our body to use very sudden energy and then crash. We need a high population of good bacteria in our gut because it helps to break down our food consistently and effectively and helps the body to receive the nutrients that it needs to receive. Eating foods such as fruits and vegetables, berries are high in antioxidants, spinach and asparagus are high in folate, which are also very good for the neurotransmitters. Omega-3 foods such as wild-caught fish, so salmon, even chia seeds and flaxseed. Healthy fats, so avocados, using extra virgin olive oil and coconut oil or walnuts. Lean protein, so grass-fed beef, organic chicken, and vitamins, especially vitamins D3, B-complex, fish oil, and probiotics, will be overall beneficial to reducing depression. It is important to know that when struggling with depression, though, we need the company of our loved ones. So whether that's family members or friends, carve out time to talk with them. Surround yourself with uplifting friendships, and remember that quality is more important than quantity in terms of friends. Try to stay involved within the community or activities that you enjoy. It is so beneficial to make time to do the things that we love, whether that is a hobby or some form of self-care treatment. Make time as well to journal with what you are feeling and struggling with. Writing down such thoughts can help relieve the space they're taking up in your mind and heart. Setting a routine, especially a sleep schedule, can help further the healing process when dealing with depression. Exercise helps boost our mood because it helps release endorphins, which are natural feel-good hormones. Yet exercising can be especially hard to do when struggling with depression, but even a small walk will go a long way. So be patient with and pace yourself. Taking time to be in the outdoors, whenever and if you can, is also very beneficial in reducing depression. The effect of sunlight is very valuable, as it helps increase the release of serotonin in our brains, which in turn helps boost our mood. But in the dark months of winter, sun lamps are a useful alternative. So now I will go into remedies for anxiety. As I explained earlier, exercise is an important component in reducing depression, since it helps boost our mood by releasing endorphins. In terms of struggling with anxiety, exercise especially helps since it also refocuses our stress into physical activity. It invigorates and refreshes not only our bodies, but our minds as well. Meditation and deep breathing exercises are ways to reduce anxiety and help provide a consistent, calming nature. Meditation is a practice of mindfulness, being intentional with what you are telling yourself, taking away the disturbing or negative thoughts and replacing them with calm and/or positive thoughts. Deep breathing exercises help to keep panic attacks at bay, for when feeling very stressed, we tend to take shallow breaths, causing us to take quicker breaths and increase our heart rate. So the deep breathing exercises help maintain a steady heartbeat by the measured breaths taken. For example, breathe in your nose for 2 seconds, pause, and then breathe out with pursed or puckered lips for 4 counts. One of my favorite ways, actually, to incorporate these two practices is through yoga. There are also herbal remedies for anxiety, which can be found in various teas. Commonly known and effective are lavender, chamomile tea. These and other herbal remedies for anxiety also can come in capsule form. Aromatherapy. Aromatherapy is one of my favorite remedies to help combat anxiety. The inhaling of essential oils can help boost your mood as well as calm nerves. Some of the essential oils that are very effective in treating anxiety are lavender, ylang ylang, frankincense, and bergamot oil. These, as well as a diffuser, are worth the investment and can be bought off of Amazon or Target, you name it, for a reasonable and affordable price. One of my favorite essential oil blends I like to use in my diffuser is the Olinear Anxiety Relief Blend, which has lemon, orange, bergamot, geranium, tangerine, jasmine, and ylang ylang oil. Last but not least, a very easy and helpful strategy to soothing anxiety is listening to calm classical music. There are so many playlists on YouTube dedicated to helping you study and bring you relaxation through tranquil classical pieces. So all this to say, depression and anxiety is very prevalent today, especially among college students. I myself am on this journey, and I've been so for the past 3 years. But with these natural remedies, as well as medication and counseling, I have been able to continue moving forward and living a fulfilling life. So if you notice that you have been experiencing any of the symptoms previously discussed, remember that you are not alone, and that help is always accessible, whether that is through natural remedies and or professional help.